We are busy with the second coming of Christ. And remember, yesterday I brought a message to you to bring you hope in this time that we are living in. So we search the scriptures and we find the place where Paul stand trial before Felix. It was if Paul was saying to Felix, Felix, you can do with me whatever you want, because my hope is in Yahu Elohim. That's what he said. Acts 24. And he said, there is a better hope for me, the resurrection of the dead. That means, he said, you can put me to death, but I will be resurrected. And I am standing trial because I believe in the resurrection of Christ. So we find this blessed hope in the book of Titus when Paul wrote to Titus. And he said, Titus, you must look for the blessed hope. Here is the key to the blessed hope. Do you want to know? Because in that same verse, Titus 2 referred to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Have an expectation of the return of the Messiah. That is the blessed hope. And when the Lord himself is saying, now encourage one another with these words. This is exactly what this teaching is all about. I am here to encourage you about these words. I cannot encourage you by telling you, hold on, you will go through the tribulation. Yes, indeed, there are saints that will go through the tribulation, but they harden their heart. And I'm going to tell you something today about this, how you will not enter into the promised land because of your rebellion and because of hardening your heart because of unbelief. When you have unbelief, you harden your heart, you walk in rebellion, and you will not be able to go into the promised land. Nevertheless, the text that I want to share with you today is, I want to interrupt myself because there is very important information for you to understand this. And these are the words of Christ Jesus himself. In John 8, the Lord is saying that I am the light of this world. And when you embrace me, listen carefully, when you embrace me, you will experience life-giving light and you will never walk in darkness again. It's amazing how the Lord, the first words ever recorded in history, when the Lord spoke, let there be light. And he separated the light from the darkness, and that is exactly what the Lord is talking here about. He is saying, when I appear on planet Earth to restore it, I separate the light from the darkness. When you are born again, immediately light is in your spirit man. And he separate that light from the darkness. Where is the darkness? In your soul. And that's why you need to experience even soul salvation on this earth. How are we doing this? To get rid of our bloodline curses. 1. 2. Constantly repent. Give up the resentment. Clean your soul with all the filthiness of unbelief, unloving spirit, rejection, resentment, abandonment, not worthy, and so I can go on. And now the Lord proceeds and he said something new to his disciples. John 8:21, the Lord is saying, I am about to leave you because I am not from this world. And then these profound words, I am. The moment since I read that Jesus said himself, I am not from this world, I am from above. Immediately, I turned to John 3:3. And I think you are familiar with the scripture. John 3:3 is when Nicodemus came to the Lord and he asked him a question. And the Lord replied, Nicodemus, hoe is dit dat jy nie weet dat jy weer gebore moet word nie? En Nicodemus was nie een gewone man op straat nie. Hy was die hoof van die synode. Hy was die hoë priester. Hy het die skrifte geken. And then the Lord said, Nicodemus, if you are not born again, listen very carefully to these words. If you are not born again, you cannot see the kingdom. It did not say that you cannot enter. He said, if you are not born again, you cannot see the kingdom. We must have a born again experience. And now the Lord proceeded and he said, Nicodemus, unless you are born, listen, out of water and in the spirit you cannot enter. Many years ago when the people told me, you must be baptized, I said, but I was already sprinkled. Are you telling me I'm not going to heaven? And they did not say anything. Today I can have boldness to tell you, if you did not come out of water into the spirit, you will not enter the kingdom. This is what the scripture is saying. And I don't care what your pastor is telling you. This is the words of the Messiah himself. But then he continues. He said that you must be born from above. Why? Because the Messiah is not from the world. He is from above. And now we find these profound words in 1 Corinthians 44, where Paul explained it to us. He said, there is an earthly body, so there must be also a spiritual body. And then he continues, he said, the first Adam was formed from the dust, but the second Adam from the realm of the heaven was born from above. And then he said, the first Adam, which was formed from the dust, he has a race looking like himself, coming out of the dust. But the one coming from the heaven realm has also a race. Since our previous states, we are descendants from Adam by nature. Henceforth, we need a born-again experience so that we can now follow Christ. And that is exactly what Paul's word begins in this chapter when he explained these two Adams. He said, the natural man preceded the spiritual man, which means that you will be born natural from a corruptible seed. You need a born-again experience from an incorruptible seed so that you can enter the kingdom of heaven. And then the Lord continues back in John 8. He said, when you embrace everything that I am teaching you, you will never experience death. You will experience death if you remain in your old fallen states. You need to be born again. You need to be baptized unto Christ in the water and unto the Holy Spirit. I can guarantee you, those who are not born from above will not be resurrected in the first resurrection. That's what the scripture is telling us. And now, the good news. We spoke about it yesterday. John 14, verse 1, the Lord is saying, don't let your fear overcome you. Don't worry. Don't let your fear overcome you. Why is he saying that? Because now the next verse gives us the answer. I am going back to my Father who sent me from above. But in his home, there are many dwelling places, and I'm going to prepare a place for you. Don't worry. Don't let your fear overtake you, because I am coming back. I promise you, I am coming back, and I will take you to that place where I am. Saints, that rest is our dominion rest. Dominion rest is ons heerskapie rus. And now Paul warns. Hebrew 3 and 4. I want to go in depth in Hebrew 3 and 4. And you can listen to that teaching of me, the bride, ready or captive. I fully discuss Hebrew 3 and 4. Just to give you an overview before we go into the scriptures. Hebrew 3, Paul quoted David in the Psalm 95, where David wrote that because of their unbelief and their rebellion, constantly rebel, they could not enter their dominion rest, their promised land. So Paul explained it in Hebrew 3, and he said, because of their rebellion spirit, their bodies were found dead in the desert. Because the Lord said, in my wrath I swear that you will not enter into my promised land. Chapter 4, then Paul explained it even further, and he said, let not your hearts be hardened. Don't walk in rebellion like the ancestors. Don't constantly have unbelief. You see, for 40 years they saw the miracles, Paul wrote, but they did not believe. And then the Lord said, I swear by my oath that you will not enter into my dominion rest. You will not enter the promised land. And Paul said, for you to go into your rest, like Yeshua just announced. I will come and fetch you, so that I will take you to a place of rest. I am convinced today that you might miss the rest because of unbelief. You know, it's astonishing how people is coming to me and said, independently where they think the rapture will take place. A person will say, I am a pre-trip believer, but somebody has a teaching and I'm now a post-trip. I'm used to be a no-trip, but I think we will be a mid-trip. Based on teachings, nobody came to me and said, listen, I discovered this. I can tell you with boldness that I had not listened to teachings. Yes, the teachings brought me to my conclusions, but I studied the word of the Lord. And when somebody say to me that there is no trip, a post-trip, a mid-trip, then I refer to the scriptures. And that is what the teaching is all about. I can only tell you what the scripture is saying. And the scripture is saying, John 8, I am going back to my Father's house, and I will come back and I will come and fetch you to take you where I am so that you can rest. And clearly, Paul took 2 chapters in the book of Hebrews just to explain to us that there is a possibility for us not to enter into our rest because of rebellion and unbelief. If you constantly wave forward and backwards with unbelief, I am worthy, I'm not. I go, no, we don't go. There is a rapture, no, there isn't. Then that is unbelief. The Lord is making promises to us. If I'm telling you us, I am speaking to the called out ones. Listen carefully to my words today. I am speaking to the called out ones, not the church. In the book, it is wrongly translated in the Bible in English. The word is ecclesia, the called out ones. You are called out from Babylon. You are called out from the four walls of the church. We are not supposed to worship once a week. We are supposed to rule and reign 7 days a week. That is exactly what the Shulamite bride is coming back for, to rule and reign. So make up your mind. We are here to rule and reign. That was the great commission to Adam and Eve. Have dominion over the fish and the sea and everything in the air. Jy moet heers. Jy kan nie heers om te worship 1 keer 'n week vir 1 uur nie. Of vir 7 ure nie. Jy moet heers oor die natuur. Jy moet heers oor jou eie body. Jy moet heers oor jou lewe. Authority has been given to Christ, and now that authority has been given to us so that we can rule and reign with Him. So I hope now that I can release more hope to you. I am not sure if you know about it. The spiritual root of Parkinson's disease is a diverted hope, a uitgestelde hoop. Dan kry jy Parkinson. So ek wil vir jou vanmôre hoop gee. Want in jou hoop kan jy geloof release. When we have hope, the blessed hope, looking for the soon return of the Messiah, embracing everything that He is teaching us, we will be indeed His disciples. When we are born from above, we are a race from the second Adam coming from the heavenly realm, where He is currently busy preparing a place for us to come and fetch us to rest. And you can miss it because of unbelief and the rebellion spirit. Let's go into Hebrews 3 and 4 and we go through all the scriptures there and we continue with this teaching, embracing me as part of the blessed hope. So Paul actually warned us now in Hebrews 3 in verse 12, when he says, search your hearts every day, my brother and sister, and make sure that none of you has evil or unbelieving hiding within you. Notice that both evil and unbelieving must not hiding in our hearts, for it will lead you astray and make you unresponsive to the living God. I think this is what is going on planet Earth today. These things of unbelief and evil in our hearts make us unresponsive to the living God and to the Holy Spirit. This is the time to encourage each other to neither be stubborn or hardened by sin's deceitfulness. Saints, that is why I am recording this teaching, is to encourage you. This is not the time to be stubborn and to harden your heart. The same people who were delivered from bondage and brought out of Egypt by Moses, now Paul is referring to the people of Israel, they were the ones who had heard and still rebelled. They grieved God for 40 years by sinning in their unbelief until they dropped dead in the desert. So God swore an oath that they would never enter into his dominion rest because of their disobedience. They disobeyed the Lord. Paul continues, verse 19, it is clear that they could not enter into their inheritance because they wrapped their hearts in unbelief. I want to encourage you not to wrap your heart in unbelief, as Paul continues in Hebrews 4. Now God has offered to us the same promise of entering into his realm of rest in confident faith. If you want to go into your rest, there must be a confident faith. Henceforth, I try to bring hope to you so that you can release faith. So we must be extremely carefully to ensure that we all embrace the fullness of the promise and not fail to experience it, Paul is saying. Verse 2, for we have heard the good news of deliverance just as they did, yet they did not join their faith with the word. The King James is saying they did not mix their faith with the word of the Lord. Now is the time to mix our faith with the promises of the Messiah. What is the first promise in the blessed hope? I promise you, I will return, and I will come and fetch you, and I will take you where I am, so that you can rest. Now you need faith to release it, so that you and me can find deliverance. But Paul warns us, for we have heard the good news of deliverance just as they did, yet they did not join their faith with the word. Instead, what they heard did not affect them deeply, for they doubted. The King James says it like this, unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For those of us who believe, faith activates the promise and we experience the realm of confident rest. Those who first heard the good news of deliverance failed to enter into the realm of rest because of their unbelieving hearts. Yet the fact remains that we still have the opportunity to enter into our rest and experience the fulfillment of the promise. Are you hearing? It is a promise given by Yeshua HaMashiach himself. And if we want to fulfill that promise, we need the opportunity now to release faith. For God still had ordained a day for us to enter into called today. Now, if the promise of rest was fulfilled when Joshua brought the people into the land, Paul wrote, God would not have spoken later of another rest yet to come. So, we conclude that there is still a full and complete rest waiting for the believers to experience. As we enter into God's faith rest life, we cease from our own works, just as God celebrates his finished works and rest in them. So then we must give our all and be eager to experience this faith rest, that no one falls short by following the same pattern of doubt and unbelief. Let's look now at the words of John 16, when Yeshua is speaking here. Verse 5, but now that I am about to leave you and go back to join the one who sent me, you need to be told. So Jesus came here and he said, I am soon going to move away from you. And then comes the promise in John 14. I promise that I will never leave you helpless or abandon you as orphans. I will come back to you. Soon I will leave this world and they will see me no longer. But now, Jesus is saying, but you will see me again. It's amazing. The disciples did not catch it. He said, soon I must go away. Where to? To my Father's throne. To do what? To show the first fruit waving offering. And then he will come back and the disciples will see him again. He said, because I will live again and you will come alive too. Today I am saying to each and every listener, Yeshua promised that he will come back for us. And I am telling you, when you mingle now your faith with his word, you too will come alive again. So when that day comes, you will know that I am living in the Father and that you are one with me, for I will be living in you. Jesus continues, verse 16, I will ask the Father to give you another Savior, The Holy Spirit of truth, who will be to you a friend just like me, and he will never leave you. The world won't receive him because they can't see him or know him, but you know him intimately because he will make his home in you and will live inside of you. Glory to God that Jesus' departure to the Father to outpour the Holy Spirit on us so that he lives now in us and bring the truth to us. And now Jesus brings this news in verse 30. I won't speak with you much longer, for the ruler of the dark world is coming. Saints, we are aware that the ruler of the dark world is now coming. But Jesus said, but he has no power over me, for he has nothing to use against me. Only way that this ruler of the dark world can come to me and to you is when he have something against you and me. And I am working on a daily basis with this, that we break the legal right that Satan has in our bloodlines. You have to break the legal rights so that Satan can have no power over you whatsoever. And that is part of our purification process. When Paul explained to Titus that we must be pure because he is indeed pure. And then the good news is that we will be united with Christ in his likeness of his resurrection. Let's go to Romans 6.